I welcome you all to the second day of the National Convention on the Constitution of India. Today's session is on the theme, Supreme Court of India as a Constitutional Court, Challenges and Opportunities. This session will explore the role of the Supreme Court of India as a Constitutional Court, focusing on its function as the ultimate interpreter and guardian of the Constitution. The session will reflect on how the court has upheld constitutional values while also adapting to evolving societal and political dynamics. We will commence the session with the keynote address, which will be graciously delivered by Honorable Justice U.U. Lalit. I request Justice Lalit to please begin the session.
All the distinguished panelists, Professor Rajkumar, all the other distinguished members who are present here, members from the faculty, and the students. It's indeed a privilege to be here and to be addressing and to be part of a segment which is supposed to be on Supreme Court of India as a constitutional court, challenges and opportunities. I have seen this court for last almost say 40, more than 40 years, few years as a lawyer practicing in that court, then some years as a judge of the court. I have seen some of the fabulous judgments, some of the moments which have been slightly not so good. So therefore the journey has always been, at the end of that journey, perhaps my assessment is something which I'll place before you. And whatever, of course, I have learned, which happened well before I came to this court. Well, we all know what a brilliant piece of work the Constitution has been, especially during those turbulent times. When we got our independence, the literacy rate was just about 20%. Today it is almost 80%. We inherited something like more than 500 Indian states, small, big, medium size, diverse cultures, different languages, different backgrounds from which the entire people came. And at the same time, there were wounds of partition. So therefore, there were lakhs and lakhs of people who had come from across the border, homeless people. They also needed to be taken care of. And one of the greatest problems was essentially the oppression at a social level, what you name it under the banner as untouchability, which used to be the prevalent custom. So to find a solution to steer the nation clear through all these turbulent ideas and then to give it a charter of a vision was definitely a task before the constitution makers. And this they did perform fabulously well. After almost 3.5 years of hard work, those constitution makers gave us a beautiful document, and we principally are commemorating, celebrating that in the 75 years of adoption of that constitution. Soon after the adoption of constitution, Dr. Ambedkar went on record to say that if, according to me, there is the cornerstone of this constitution or the most important article of the constitution, it is Article 32. And what a great visionary idea that was. Article 32, and especially if you see it from the prism of Article 13, which is one of the fundamental rights itself, that gives you a power which is so wide all through the world, perhaps the widest judicial review power which has been conferred upon the Supreme Court. 32 on the original side, 136 as an appellate court, and you have a beautiful combination of two powers which get coalesced in one single body. and that body was entrusted with the task of interpreting constitution, laying down certain good norms of governance through judicial pronouncements. And this has been the journey. If you see right from the first case, which was Gopalan, which was fought on what? On the dimensions of Article 21, as it was advocated by one of the greatest lawyers, M.K. Nambiar. Unfortunately, he did not succeed on that issue. The dissenting note by Justice Fazal Ali actually brings it out so well, what was argued by Mr. Nambiar before the court. And what he advocated then thereafter became the accepted notion in R.C. Cooper and subsequently in Maneka Gandhi. So therefore, right from that first case down the line to the present cases and present scenario, if you see the journey of this Supreme Court, 32 has always been the cornerstone. Whether you see it through the prism of Article 13, starting from, say, Sankari Prasad, Sajjan Singh, and then right up to Golaknath, it used to be the prism of Article 13, which thereafter gave way to the beautiful principle that we have come to accept and adopt, basic structure doctrine. And that is exactly what the Supreme Court has always been trying to protect the individual rights on one side, and at the same time, the aspirations of the people on the other. If you ask me in this development journey, I would put it that post-1990 has a special significance when it comes to Indian scenario. And why? Around 1990, Manmohan Singh announced what is called liberalization of economic policies in this country, which was one idea. Around that time, 92 came what is called Indira Sahni. And you had one dimension getting open, that is essentially what? Affirmative action getting too broad. Broadening the aspects of affirmative action, which resulted in what? Which resulted in seeing that perhaps the opportunities should go to the remotest corners and at the lowest levels of the societal hierarchy. Add to it one more dimension, and that is 1993 Unnikrishnan. So around that time, you have these three important developments. Unnikrishnan, for the first time, gave another dimension to right to life, which was expounded in Maneka Gandhi, to say that if right to life means that every citizen must have the atmosphere to reach the highest potential of his or her life as an individual, then such kind of idea will be useless unless and until you give education, free and compulsory education, to the children of this country in the age group of 6 to 14. Unnikrishnan broke one barrier, and that is to say that directive principles of state policy are non-enforceable. So it said that very well, we'll still rely on one of the articles from directive principles of state policy to say that, yes, even 44 years down the line, the state hasn't been able to extend the benefit of free and compulsory education to every child in this country. And we now make it compulsory. To my mind, we keep complaining, criticizing about the judicial activism, quote unquote, as an idea. This was the greatest example of judicial activism. To say that every right, every child has a right to be educated, and put the burden on what? On the shoulders of the state. We have seen the history of, you know, whenever the Supreme Court has decided something, say for instance, even Indira Sahni, on three counts there were three constitutional amendments. Indira Sahni said no reservation in promotion, nullified by the parliament, by way of an amendment. Indira Sani said, while dealing with that office memorandum, that 10% TWS impermissible, again comes an amendment. So therefore, these are some of the three ideas which were floated in Indira Sani, nullified by the parliament. But what was floated in Unnikrishnan was accepted by the parliament, not a word of demur. It took them 9 years to say that very well, you know, going by the kind of impact that it will have, every child to be educated in the country will require tremendous finances. So therefore, the states must first put their house in order. And therefore, 93 comes Unnikrishnan, 2002 comes the constitutional amendment, which now makes 21A a fundamental right. And it gets a rightful place next to Article 21, because that's what Unnikrishnan said. And that's the greatest sort of, you know, acknowledgement of the role of the Supreme Court. If you really want to see the role of the Supreme Court getting acknowledged, it is that particular judgment which finds acceptance in getting that particular fundamental right. What have we seen the progression? Of course, yes, we say that 14, 19, 21, this is the tripod of everything, along with 32, these make what is called four wheels of a chariot. We have seen one fundamental right getting out of that part, 19.1F getting out, but 21A entering the part three rights. And this is nothing but because of the some kind of, call it activist role, call it judicial activism, call, name whatever you wish to. But that's the kind of, you know, spirited response by the Supreme Court, which has seen the acceptance in having that as a fundamental right. It's a very difficult task to be putting everything in a capsulized version in the shortest possible time, but let me just put it this way. Has the Supreme Court lived up to those challenges? Yes. It gave us that beautiful doctrine, basic structure. Since then, there have been 7 cases in which constitutional amendments have been struck down. Starting from what? Keshwanand Bharati, Indira Nehru Gandhi, then comes Minerva Mills, then comes Sambamurthy, Justice Bhagwati's judgment, then comes Kyoto Holohan, then comes L. Chandra Kumar, and finally comes NJAC. Now, these are judgments, if you just actually see the common thread running through that, what is it? Either judicial review or independence of judiciary. Something to get connected with, again, what is Article 32, which means the right of every citizen to approach the judicial organ for redressal. Any attempt to curb that right, any attempt to hit at that was something which has not been accepted by the Supreme Court, to the extent that constitutional amendments also had to perish. See it in the context of 2 other amendments, just by way of sample. When Sikkim became the part of the union, one of the provisions in the amendment said that let there be 1 seat for Buddhist monasteries or sanghas. The challenge was raised that how can that be permissible in a country which is supposed to be embracing a principle that country doesn't have a religion, the state doesn't have religion. And yet that constitutional amendment was accepted. It was not struck down. The last example is EWS. When you want to make a distinction and say that very well, let there be 1 more class of beneficiary for affirmative action. Again, of course, there was a minority view, a dissenting note, but the majority view is that yes, it is permissible. It is on the right side. So therefore, that's where the Supreme Court has actually given us everything, whatever the aspirations of the country, the countrymen, the citizens have been. Of course, there have been challenges. I have seen this institution over a period of 40 years. It never used to be that a matter which is filed would not even come up for hearing for months together. That is definitely a malady which is now gripping the entire judicial organ, and that is the pendency, the backlog. That is one part which needs to be addressed at a war footing. At the same time, my individual idea is that perhaps I think we are widening the scope of appellate jurisdiction of the court too wide. Every single legislation which comes, say tariff legislation, whether it is TDSAT legislation, whether it is Armed Forces Tribunal, whether it is National Consumers, every legislation seeks to give an appellate jurisdiction to the Supreme Court, which really adds to the burden of the Supreme Court. Perhaps I think a relook is definitely necessary. And rather than having a constitutional appellate court, because that was exactly what Justice Matthew once had suggested, let's have a statutory appellate tribunal in between, rather than giving all statutory appellate jurisdiction to the Supreme Court. There have been number of such instances, number of such legislations which have recently been passed. To sum it, last 75 years have been a golden period. I would say post 1993 Unnikrishnan, and you will see the difference. The literacy rate is now at 80% level. The youth of this country, with the kind of education that it is getting as a result of this compulsory education, is now so empowered that all over the world, human resource is where people look towards India. And that's why our engineers, our technocrats, our researchers are actually at a level where everybody gets accepted in some of the other jurisdictions and countries. Our youth is presently at a stage where perhaps I think we will be a changing force. Our per capita income, which used to be just about 236 in 1947, is more than 1,13,000 now, and we are still progressing further. All of this is essentially, and I would put it, the seeds are there in post-1990 scenario, and one of them is definitely the greatest contribution by the Supreme Court. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Justice Lalit, for painting the broader brushstrokes of judicial activism for us. It's always a pleasure to listen to you, sir. And I now request Professor Dr. Khagesh Gautam to please take over the session.
Thank you, Supriya. Thank you, Chief Justice, for your enlightening remarks. I welcome all of you to this panel. We are all assembled here to contemplate on the Supreme Court of India as a constitutional court. I'll just take a couple of minutes to briefly reflect on the remarks made by the Chief Justice. In the opening panel, I made a very brief remark that for 75, and I say this as a professor of constitutional law, I say this as a member of probably the most respected peer group of constitutional faculty that we have been able to build in this country. I do not know where the spirit of the Constitution is. Since 1951, this quest goes on. The Chief Justice says that Article 32 is a cornerstone of the nation. He's right. He mentioned the history of basic structure doctrine. He's again right. But again, to tie the point off, what's the job of the Supreme Court as a constitutional court? Certainly, it's not just an appellate court. It was never intended to be. But my question today, perhaps, is, which sets the general theme, is what is the highest purpose that a constitutional court can aspire for? Our constitutional court has defended fundamental rights. Our constitutional court has consistently interpreted the Constitution, and our constitutional court has had the insight to find that elusive structure of the Constitution that is unamendable. But here we have in the panel today Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi, and if I may, sir, it was your father, Lakshmi Mal Singhvi, in 1973, 51 years back, in Puran Mal Singh's case, Puranmal versus Director of Investigation, 5-judge bench. He tried to convince the court where the spirit is, but he wasn't able to. 50 years have passed. We still do not know where the spirit is. And today, before I invite, before I begin this session by asking my first question, I hope and I pray that we have the blessings of our constitutional ancestors today with that spirit. May that spirit reveal itself to us in this panel today. So with that, I'll start this panel. I'll be putting a few questions to all the panelists and inviting the responses, and we'll continue in this vein. So my first question, of course, to Dr. Abhishek Singhvi, we'll start the panel with you, sir. My first question is, the principle of judicial review, as the Chief Justice also just mentioned, is cornerstone of our constitution. We have historical authority and contemporary experience to support that. My question to you, sir, is how can the court ensure that its exercise of judicial review is both effective in protecting constitutional values and respectful of the separation of powers among the branches of the government? Dr. Singhvi.
Two preliminary points. All of us have to be brief, so I'll be very pointed. One, a very, very special, special congratulations to the Vice Chancellor. There is a wide hiatus between conception, design versus execution and delivery. We've been talking of this a few months ago, and I'm absolutely stunned to see the amount of work which has been actually delivered on time. The second preliminary point is that you're kind enough to mention Puran Singh, which I had actually forgotten, but there's a closer connection. I was present and standing next to my father when he drafted the Law Day Constitution in the late 80s. And that charter was then drafted, and it then became an annual event in every court in India, of course, starting with the Supreme Court. And now it is a very good thing that it has become a Constitution Day after so many years. Now, as far as your question is concerned, I think we need to accept the fact that India's contours and boundaries of judicial review are humongous. I always say that it would make Marbury and Madison blush. They would make Dicean theorists cringe, because there is no limit to the kind of judicial review our courts exercise. So I don't think we should waste time on theories like unelected judges or the Scalian approach to literal original intent or the text. We have gone far, far beyond that. Number two, I personally believe it's a good thing. Much more good has been done by somewhat erratic, uncontrolled judicial review than harm. Judicial review is pretty much like an unruly horse, just like PIL, which is another form of judicial review, is an unruly horse. So it depends to a large extent on the dexterity of the rider. And by and large, our riders have acquitted themselves creditably, with, of course, notable exceptions. The exception I always remember is a judge sitting on the platform of a railway station issuing mandamus about why certain trains were not running on time. So you do have those aberrations, but the aberrations don't define the rule. By and large, judicial review is something we should be proud of, and I think we should preserve it, but we must make sure that the unruly horse is ridden well. Now, before I end, I found very interesting many of the points the former Chief Justice Lalit said. Two things. I spoke on a lecture circuit in the US last year, and I said it there, and I think it's worth repeating since we're talking of the Supreme Court. I see the Supreme Court in these last 70 years, 75 years, evolutionary trajectory, as running through 5 or 6 phases. And if I might just take a minute to try and slot them into those phases, some of them will coincide with the approaches which Justice Lalit has shown. The first was clearly a consolidation phase of the 50s and the 60s, early 60s. And that was a more individual rights focused. Even though Gopalan failed, but there were a lot of other individual approaches to rights. The second was the Indira Gandhi pushback from the 60s to the 70s, which led to a greater emphasis on social and economic rights. And they're all facets of judicial review in some form or the other. And that was also the time when both directive principles and fundamental rights, till the early and mid-70s, were looked at in a very much more synergical, harmonious manner. And then came the positivistic, excessively deferential court of the emergency era. We had our Dred Scott moment. We had our Levisage and Anderson moment in ADM Jabalpur. And then it went on to what that nice phrase Professor Bakshi used, the post-emergency quest for legitimation by the Supreme Court. Legitimate quest for legitimation. And that led to the restart of a vigorous era of judicial review, which has now continued in the last two phases, the fifth one being as we crossed into the millennium, a greater focus on all these equality, transparency, civic rights, environmental rights, and on to now the period ending with the last Chief Justice, a more liberal court, trying usually to speak truth to power, not always successfully, but trying. So I think this has been, but the uniting feature for all these phases has been a very clear use, expansion, vigorous application, mostly for the good, bona fide application of judicial review in a country as diverse as India. And this judicial review has absolutely no parallel anywhere in the world, and in fact is not comparable to any other court that I know of.
See, judicial review starting from Marbury versus Madison, and as he rightly said, that we have gone miles beyond that. When you discuss the kind of powers that our Supreme Court exercises with some of the judges from other jurisdictions, they are flabbergasted. They can't even imagine that this kind of power can be exercised by the judges. Starting from, say, challenging the assembly dissolution in Mumbai, we have actually, there is no subject that the Supreme Court or the courts cannot even go into. So therefore, let's put it this way, that there is absolutely no exception. So therefore, that's the kind of power that we exercise. But at the same time, you know, the Supreme Court has always been conscious of the width of the power and therefore the circumspection which must actually be bestowed every time when you exercise that power. There have been cases like, for instance, if there is an absence of everything in your exercise, you have come out with Vishakha guidelines, you have come out with DK Basu, where the gentleman on my left side was also responsible as amicus curiae. We have done something on the forest issues, which perhaps I think the executive was not able to take care of that issue. Vehicular pollution. So therefore, name it and you will have the tentacles of the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court entering into that field. And that is something which is possible by the judiciary, which is conscious of its rights, its kind of powers, and at the same time, what is required to be done in the particular fact situation or scenario. And that's what the amalgam is, something what we normally call, what is your judicial review issue. So therefore, again, going back that, if you put it, say, in whichever form, the judicial review principles have always been dear to the Supreme Court. That's why I gave you seven examples where constitutional amendments have been struck down. Why? Because judicial review was sought to be taken out of the complete kind of idea. A paragraph in, say, 10 schedule said that speaker's order shall be final. Sorry, it cannot be. So therefore, judicial review is still available. It came to Chandra Kumar, you name it and you will have all these seven cases touching upon or entering that field. And that is what this principle has always been dear to the Supreme Court, very close to its heart, and rightfully so. Yes.
Pardon me, I've been remiss. I didn't introduce the panelists, so please let me fill that gap. We have Professor Sital Kalantry, Mr. Venkataramani, the Attorney General. Of course, you have heard from should I say Chief Justice or proudly Professor Lalit? I'm not so sure right now. We have Mr. Abhishek M, Singh, and of course the legendary Professor MP Singh. AG, my next question is to you, sir. This is a difficult question, and of course, you're the best person to answer this. In your opinion, sir, do you think the Supreme Court has been able to protect its institutional independence while addressing politically sensitive cases? And of course, in the light of your lived experience at the bar, what's the best way to handle a politically sensitive case? I'm sure law students here will be very interested in that particular question. Over to you, sir.
I think over a period of time, as a practitioner of law and as an academic, trying to teach students, and I have come close to a point of view that we need a new theory of courts. We've all been looking at the administrative law, judicial review in England. We've been looking at what's happening in USA, the long unwinding debates in USA, I think, which we need not delve too deep into them because they don't really come close to the Indian situations. So we need to look at what can, the next 25 years, the judicial review powers and the assertion of the Supreme Court in its independence to explore all possible spectrum of engaging in the exercise of reviewing what the state can do and cannot do. Ultimately, it's all about what the court can come to a conclusion on the larger social, political, and economic processes. We always say, can the court substitute its own views? I think again, when in 1970s, when Professor Griffiths wrote the politics judiciary, it was a big issue in UK. So we're not talking about the politics of judiciary. Every institution of governance, I suppose, will have its role to play. And I suppose ultimately we are talking about assertion of independence. How do judges learn to move the line between independence and an excess of independence? So the moving of the line is a very important lesson which judges will learn. I'm sure that the Supreme Court has learned that lesson very, very, very cleverly and very in a wise and mature way. I don't think we have what happened, debates in USA about a conservative court and a liberal court and things like that do not really fit in the Indian situation. We had mixes of judges in the Supreme Court. And that's the beauty of it. And I don't think we need to go beyond this minimal statement. Probably what we'll probably talking about in some time to come is, given the range of issues the Supreme Court will have to keep looking into, and then more importantly, by way of asserting its independence, are we talking about a minimalist constitution? Where a larger role, while you assert your independence as an institution, but perhaps will the court say that I have a final word on many of policy and social, economic, and political choices? 1950 was a different story. 1970 was again a different story. But today we are a globalized nation. Every nation is a globalized nation. So for the political process to decide on what is most relevant, important, and good for the nation, you will have multiple views on those subjects. So I think democracy is all about multiple views, and who will pick up which is the best view? So I don't think it's not a question of independence of judiciary, but more importantly is how do we convert this institution into a more deliberative institution, and where deliberations assist the social, economic, and political process. I think citizens, institutions of governance, and the institution of judiciary constitute a holy alliance. And how do we really ensure that these angles of a triangle do not move beyond the point? The triangle collapses. So it's a very delicate balance. And as we move further into a globalized nation, this delicate balance will have to be kept in mind.
And I don't think there's a danger for independent judiciary at all.
May I please invite Professor Singh to share his thoughts on this question?
I am supposed to still interpret it and also to revise it from time to time. Professor V.N. Shukla, who was my teacher, and I have great respect for him, that I had the opportunity of studying with him, not only for my LLM, but also for my LLD degree from Lucknow University. I started with him. It's unfortunate, very unfortunate that he died in between, and I could not complete the work during his time, but it was completed later on. And from time to time, I have been given the responsibility by the Eastern Book Company that I should revise his book, which I have been doing so far. I am not speaking especially on the issues which have been raised here, but this is also a fact that there is a need not only to give law only in an institution like the university here, but also to give the essence of the constitution to the people in the villages also. And that requires a lot of work, not simply giving sermons to them, but also to translate something which is written in the constitution into what can be done for the people in the country in general. Country, of course, is moving very fast, and there are changes which I think they have to be celebrated, but at the same time, there are many things which country needs to be done again and again, and perhaps we have to devote a lot of time for that. I am not claiming anything at the moment. Please excuse me if I have not answered your question, which was not very specific also.
Professor Kalantry, my next question is to you. You have been studying the Supreme Court of India for a very long time. With societal norms now changing at an unprecedented pace, the Supreme Court, of course, faces significant challenges in interpreting the Constitution. Professor, how do you think these challenges will affect the ability of our Supreme Court to defend constitutional principles while dealing with contemporary problems? And what strategies do you think could be implemented to better navigate this challenging landscape?
I'm excited to be here to celebrate the launch of the Constitution Museum. It makes me proud both as a scholar of India and the Indian Supreme Court, but also as a member of the Indian diaspora community to see this museum here. This moment is an appropriate time to ask what the Constituent Assembly members would think about the institution they created, the Indian Supreme Court. Let's imagine their spirits walk out of the fourth floor of that museum and walk into this room and are sitting amongst us. What do they see, right? They know that in 1950, the Supreme Court of India had 8 judges sitting in large benches, having heard 1,046 cases and decided 46 judgments. Today, the court has 34 judges who are struggling to keep up with the demand for their time. They hear over 60,000 petitions a year, issue 1,000 published judgments, and admit about 14% of the cases before them. I think the Constituent Assembly members might have also been surprised that 11 different men have been Chief Justices of India in the last 11 years, and one man has been Prime Minister over that same time. They may not have imagined that the 65-year mandatory retirement age that they wrote into the Constitution would result in the Chief Justice being in power for an average of 9 months. When a Chief Justice is in power for such a short time, they find it difficult to develop their foothold, create the institutional stability that's needed for a court, and adapt to the changing role of an apex court in Indian society. The Constituent Assembly members might have also been surprised to see the collegium, right? They may not have imagined that when they wrote the provision, in the appointments provision, that it would become that the Chief Justice and the four senior most judges nominate other judges. And the collegium also has, in their work, decreased the time that judges spend on the court. So in our work, we found that the collegium appoints judges at a higher age than when judges were appointed under the executive-led system that existed from 1950 to 1993. So this not only means that the Chief Justices are there for a shorter period of time because of the seniority norm, but also that judges, on average, spend 5 years on the Supreme Court. Life expectancy was 40 at the time, and it's around 70, depending on who you are. And this young retirement age has potentially created incentives to pander to the government. After retirement, the government is the single largest employer still of Supreme Court judges. And one study, not mine, suggests that judges do pander to governments for jobs. This is out of the National University of Singapore. The Constituent Assembly members might also be surprised to see this sheer volume of cases creates a situation where judges are sitting 2 days a week just listening to petitions, which means on average they spend 90 seconds on each petition, which potentially also gives rise to the importance of the advocate that is arguing the case, right? The grand advocates that have sitting amongst us. The assembly members might be surprised that the court hears only about 4% of the cases on constitutional matters. The bulk of its work is devoted to special leave petitions. I don't know if they imagined that the Article 136 would become the biggest source of their work. So to deal with the deluge of litigation, the court creates two judge benches that decide over 90% of its cases. And in part because of these two judges, these two judge benches, they make it difficult to set precedent because one two-judge bench might rule X on a same set of issues where a different two-judge bench might rule differently, making it difficult for lower courts to also have precedent. In fact, one study found that around half the cases decided by the court cite no law at all. And 60% of the cases decided after 1990 are never cited by the court in any subsequent case. A byproduct of not being selective about cases is that, of course, it invites more litigation. People who have money will come to the court and say, oh, well, maybe we'll get the judge that we need, and maybe they'll decide in favor of us. And they might be surprised that the gender and caste diversity hasn't kept up if the Supreme Court. The Constitution of India, this post-World War II Constitution, was really ahead of its time, right? They enshrine notions of equality, both gender, caste, which were way ahead of society. But unfortunately, their ideas are yet to become reality in our society. And What I think they might ask us if they were sitting here and responding to our questions, I think they would say, we do want the court to reform itself. We do feel that we created a very amendable constitution, one of the most amended in the world and the easiest to amend by majority vote. And so I think they would precisely want to amend the constitution to think about reform so that the Supreme Court, its institutions, its functionings, can now really adapt to the changing nature of Indian society and be as strong as it once was and as it should be.
I think the independence of the court, institutionally or generally, is not in doubt. But your question was a more focused one about the subset of politically sensitive cases within that larger circle of independence. I think the answer there is largely positive, but a mixed bag answer. It flows very much from bench composition and brings in the biggest scourge, which my friend Professor Kalantry mentioned, bench inconsistency in the court. So you pretty much get on a draw of lot a result which will vary, if not in 17 ways, but at least in 10 ways among 17 benches. So that, I think, is the answer to the politically sensitive case. There are also, unfortunately, a few techniques which are increasing in politically sensitive cases, which need to be looked at and curbed. One is the decision not to decide. Judges do that all the time, but they do it perhaps more conveniently in more politically sensitive cases. The second is operation successful, patient dies. That has happened in a lot of politically sensitive cases, and we know the names as well. So I think that is a fair comment on otherwise a fiercely independent institution. The second point I think is more important. I'll just take a minute or two more. I'm so happy that we have a non-resident, non-practicing diaspora member on the panel here. Just like you have to speak truth to power, you have to speak truth to lawyers and judiciary. Now, I've read Professor Kalantri's last book. I don't know where she's getting these figures from. Must be a next book in the work. But almost every word she has said, I couldn't agree more with. You need this kind of incisive, somewhat brutal analysis and criticism on the statistical side of the Supreme Court. Things like 9-month averages and 50% having no judgments, etc. She has mentioned what I think is a major problem, bench inconsistency. The biggest scourge generally in an otherwise very avant-garde system, and we have the brightest judges and lawyers in the world. We have the most avant-garde doctrines like PIL and basic structure, which is the pride of India and the envy of the world. But equally, the scourge is this mammoth arrears. And let me tell Professor Kalantri and all of us, we are talking the Supreme Court here, but the Supreme Court is actually an island of success. 1.3 lakh arrears means nothing in India. In the Hindi terminology, it is not even oont ke muh mein jeera. The figure under our noses, seminars, conferences, sermons, and lectures has increased on the excuse of COVID, no doubt, from 2020 to now, from 3.5 crores, that's 35 million for our American friends, to 5 crores, which is 50 million. So the Supreme Court, 1 point some lakhs is nothing. I think that is something we need. And the tragedies, we know the solutions. We just need to target them in a systematic plan, a 3 or a 5 year plan. But we just don't seem to be doing it consistently. So we started with areas of 3.5 on which we had 70 years of seminars. And we've come now to 5 crores.
Thank you so much for this fascinating panel. Each one of you really reflected on the idea of the Constitutional Court. So I'm trying to address and request you to address the fundamental point probably Sital is making here, is that it's not so much the data that undermines the ability of the court to be effective, but also how it probably doesn't help the Supreme Court to act more effectively as a constitutional court. And here I want to draw a bit of historical context that probably when the court was not as, let's say, burdened as it is now, it had the time and the creativity and the mental space to come up with those avant-garde doctrines that you talked about, the doctrine of basic structure, or expanding locus standi and bringing in PIL. But if you look at the last, say, few decades of the evolution of the court, for all the reasons that Sital talked about, the court has not been so, let's say, having that bandwidth to be able to bring those hugely influential doctrines that not only address the big challenges of access to justice in India, but also inspired many other constitutional courts around the world. And so my question is, at least to the three of you, is that how can we sort of take the Supreme Court to that court which can actually play the leadership role in combining those creative aspirations of bringing out those doctrines and develop what you talked about, the Attorney General, a new theory of India's Supreme Court.
We think only if the court is called upon to dole out landmark judgments, we call it a constitutional court. As the social, economic and political landscape of country has changed, and the demands of citizens for resolution of their everyday humdrum disputes, I think that's part of a constitutional role of the court. If you don't look at that, I think we will talk about delay, burdens, and how the court has ceased to be what the founding fathers of the constitution envisaged the court to be. I think we need to move into a picture of the court which will discharge a variety of functions. So if you have hundreds and 200s of cases every day, I think it is what the citizens want from this court, to be part of a constitutional resolution of their everyday disputes, from bail to answering IBC questions. I think it's a different thing to say that the court must be relieved of its burden for discharging this very function effectively and qualitatively. The two things are entirely different. I see that the court will continue to be called upon to receive more and more cases, because that's how the demand of constitutional resolution, I think, is going to be.
Yeah, so, you know, addressing your question, I think people think that litigation is a bad thing, right? At least people who are not lawyers or soon to be lawyers. But litigation is a good thing for a society. It is good, it correlates with economic growth. That's shown. And so as India has grown, the litigation has grown. So that, I don't think, is a problem. I think that how you deal with the cases is the issue, right? I think the way the court has dealt with it is to just work harder, work faster, increase its bench size. And that itself, as we mentioned, creates a lack of precedent, which doesn't help guide the lower courts, right? The vision for me of what, and again, I'm coming from being educated in, you know, America, so I'm thinking about a court as a common law court that guides lower courts and sets precedent. So cases should never even come up to the Supreme Court. And so if it were able to do more of that, had more time to do more of that, which it can if it takes maybe less cases. So SLP is a very discretionary jurisdiction, and there's a lot of vested interests that don't want the court to take fewer cases. But I think taking fewer cases and setting more precedent is one way to deal with this increased litigation, which has also created longer periods of time, which, yes, based on the book that Dr. Singhvi mentioned, about 3 years a case spends in a court, but it's sort of a two-track system where some cases go much faster and another set of cases go slower. And again, that's also not what should happen. But I think if they worked slower, I think they actually would, if they worked less, they would do much better.
Thank you, Professor. We'll now moving to the concluding part of this session. First, my thanks to all the panelists here. Before I put one question, this question I put to Professor M.P. Singh, former Vice Chancellor of NUJS Calcutta, Dr. Abhishek Munusinghvi, of course, Senior Advocate, and Mr. R. Venkataramani, the AG, and Professor Sital Kalantry, who's professor at Seattle University School of Law. Panelists, my last question to all of you. In your opinion, we can all take one. We can start with the Sital. In your opinion, what do you think are going to be the most pressing challenges for the Supreme Court in the next 25 years, and how should the court prepare to address them? Over to you, panelists. And start with you.
Well, I mean, I look forward to hearing what the panelists say. I think the momentary challenge is clearly one of being strong enough to stand up to a very strong executive and a strong parliament, right? Yes, it's weaker than before, but I think that is a challenge in this last decade that the court has faced and may continue to face. And my response, obviously, has been about the institution itself. The institution and the litigation and the way it's handled it is allowing it to drown rather than to have the ability to be stronger. It doesn't necessarily mean they will, you know, because we really do have to deal with the executive as well and the parliament, but it means at least that if it was able to reform itself or was reformed, I think they would have more capacity and would be able to become a court that sets more precedent, deals with more constitutional cases. Now, it doesn't mean, just because you have more time, doesn't mean you'll issue the decisions that some people might want them to, but I think it's a necessary thing for the court to do, to figure out how to be a court that sets precedent and that takes fewer cases, and it's only then that it might be a court that is able to stand up to the executive, which, by the way, is so much more important in the Indian democracy, the role of the court, than the American democracy, because we have really three co-equal branches. Here you have more or less two, because the parliament is expanding the executive. So it's even more important for the Indian Supreme Court, because it's one of the only bulwarks against a majoritarian rule.
Thank you. AG, please.
We want the Supreme Court to become super economists. We also want the Supreme Court to become theories on all possible things. That's going to be a challenge. But I don't think I will go into file a counter affidavit against that. So I'll probably think it's important for the Supreme Court to become partly economists, social scientists, political theories, but at the bottom of it, how to draw a line in all that. It's not going to be an easy job. But then the more, I also find that as we move into a digital arena and a digital age, which is of a machine age of an entirely different kind, how is the court going to answer many of those questions which are very subtle in their understanding and application? For instance, organized crime is something beyond the borders of each country. Mm-hmm. Or the equality claim, which cannot be seen any longer in very conservative terms. So these are going to be some of the most pressing questions before the court. And as I see many of them coming before the court, sometimes I draw a backseat. Can the court do that? But in order to assist both the court and the government, I think I must be able to assist the court in order that all of us are able to find some solution. So the question is not who is giving a solution ultimately, is a solution, will the solution fare well on some normative grounds? That's going to be an issue.
Mm-hmm. Chief Justice.
I see great challenges in next 25 years. See, when the Supreme Court began, its cause list used to be published in Indian Express every day. 6 or 7 matters would be listed before the court. All those matters were published in the newspapers. If one goes back in history, in those days, even the airlines, you know, their schedules used to be published in newspapers. So Supreme Court, the kind of work, the pressure that it used to have was of that dimension. As the learned Attorney General mentioned, the aspirations of the people are so rising. People want even their genuine problems, day-to-day problems, to get sorted out at the highest level. And therefore, the clamor, the kind of responses or demands for justice are of such dimension that perhaps I think Supreme Court will have to devise certain new ways to cope up with that. One of the ways would be, and as Ms. Sital Kalantry said, that most of the judgments are not even worthy of reporting. Maybe so, because they deal with only that individual dispute. Correct? They are essentially designed to deal with that individual dispute. We need to now have a separation so far as such matters which are essentially disposal or dispute resolution oriented, and some matters which are essentially for laying down principles of law for the generations to follow. And therefore, have that distinction, do not bestow all that quotational jurisprudence just starting from one judgment right up to the last judgment. Be concise, be precise, and then deal with that matter. Perhaps the advances of technology, the young generation in the form of law assistants can be utilized to a great extent to help the judge to have wonderful homework on the front. The third part, and perhaps that's where the bar has to also come out with a solution. See, what happens in America is you have 120 matters in a year. In Canada, the same situation. In US, perhaps it is even less than 120 for the Supreme Court. So therefore, you screen those matters at the entry level. We do not believe in that. We say that very well, let the screening be done by the judges themselves sitting there on the bench. So therefore, every matter comes before the court. That's why 60,000 matters are listed before the court. Try to screen those matters at one level, just as leave to appeal is granted by the judges of the Supreme Court of US and Canada sitting in chambers. Why not us? You know, let it be listed before a bench of five judges, assisted by all kinds of law clerks. Instead of 50 matters, you can have 100 matters listed, but no oral submissions on those matters, unless and until the judges consider the matter to be listed in court. So most of these useless matters, which are actually burdening the entire docket of the court, can be lessened. And therefore, the Supreme Court will be functioning with what is called, what is expected of it. And that's what Ms. Sital Kalantry said, that if the founding fathers were to join us, is this the functioning of the court? Perhaps yes, we'll be able to answer that question. And at the same time, we'll be able to cope up with the demands of the population to have dispute resolution at the hands of the Supreme Court.
Thank you, Chief Justice. I'd like to make a brief remark for the benefit of our students. The suggestion that the Chief Justice makes is a very similar suggestion was made by a contemporary of our Vice Chancellor, Dr. Krishna Swamy, who's the Vice Chancellor of NLU Bangalore. I was a student of his in Colombia in 2012, and one of the suggestions that was prominently made amongst all the participants in that course was one practice that the Supreme Court has to change is the practice of oral argumentation. I'm very happy, Chief Justice, to hear this from you. Dr. Singhvi, one question I'll add for you. Will the spirit reveal itself?
So to be very specific and brief, three challenges, negative ones, and possibly one very positive one. The negatives are arrears, backlog. Now, I think it's wrongly phrasing a question to ask that of the Supreme Court. It's no joy for a Chief Justice of the Supreme Court to preside over a zero arrears or 20,000 arrears court when the country has 50 million arrears. The Supreme Court, in its multiple roles, is also the leader of the judicial system. It's a catalyst, it's an icon, and you have to look at the arrears for the country as a whole. That is the biggest challenge we have, and we know the answers, but that's not the time to go. I mean, reforms in the administration of justice should be a separate lecture in most law courses, is now started, but that is the biggest challenge. The second is, within the existing system, at least the Supreme Court should take steps to minimize, they can't eliminate, bench inconsistency. Whether you use technology for it, whether you use reprimand for it, whether you use greater conferences behind the scenes, this must lessen. It's a very supreme irony that when we had no computers and we as youngsters used to plod through the AIR manuals to look at cases, you had less per incurium cases. And now with computers batching and classifying, you have more per incurium cases. It's quite unfathomable. But even otherwise, I think the desire of an individual judge to leave his stamp should not be allowed to exceed the bounds of reasonableness. That leads to bench inconsistency within the court. A third is the quality of judicial appointments. It's something which is not talked about much, but it is something which you have to decide the quality before whom you are practicing, and everybody knows there's a deterioration for a variety of reasons. So these are three negatives. The positive is that you can harness, are already harnessing, and will be harnessing much more technology. Again, not enough time to speak on it, but already a lot has been done. And by the time these things happen, I think you'll be having AI, you'll be having all kinds of classification techniques, and that is something for the positive. One last thing. I think you need within the existing system, because systems like having a new intermediate court, systems like changing or abolishing oral arguments, God forbid, etc., will take time. Before that, a practical way of doing it is to have slowly at least some small two tracks. At the Supreme Court, it is possible. It's not possible for paucity of judges and huge vacancies in the high courts and the district courts. But the Supreme Court has relatively less vacancies at any point of time, especially in the recent past. So there's no reason why you cannot have the law setting, because it's a dilemma, a genuine dilemma the Supreme Court has as an appellate court and a constitutional court. It is also the reason for the highest trust organ in the country. The trust deficit attaches much more to the executive and the parliamentary branches. So if it was not doing its dual role, if it was not being inclusive and tolerant of hearing many, many, many cases, there would be a trust deficit. So to harmonize, have two tracks. And you recently had, to the credit of the last Chief Justice, almost 1.5 to 2 years of several 9, 7, 6, 5 judge benches, which were law-setting judgments. And other tracks continued as they could. So I think that harmonization will be the immediate solution for having its dual roles being discharged, not lessening the trust deficit, but also setting down law-setting judgments.
I didn't mean even the final hearing without oral hearing. It was only at the admission stage. Yes. As I said, decide in your chambers whether the matter is worthy of admission or not. Because 90% matters are actually dismissed on the first day, which means, according to the court, they are not worthy of any further hearing. So therefore, that stage you can do it in chambers. And then thereafter, of course, we would have the pleasure of listening to counsel who are on my either side.
With the live streaming of court proceedings now, all of us are in a competition on displaying our 4 and 6 skills, right, to catch the attention in many quarters. But I think that's a very important issue to be. I think Supreme Court will look into that, and many of us are engaged in debates about it, I'm sure, with the community of students and faculties across the country. We'll be able to gather some insights and work on that. But on the lighter side, I don't think any of us have consulted ChatGPT before coming here.